I'll start with a little introduction to Healthcare Denmark, what kind of organization we are and what we do. Healthcare Denmark is really a public-private partnership. We are owned 50% by the State of Denmark, the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Growth, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Danish healthcare regions and region South Denmark are our public owners. On the private side, we are owned by the Danish Chamber of Commerce and Danish Industry Association and a number of companies in healthcare. It's important to understand that even though we have certain companies on our private owner side, we work for all companies in Denmark and all public authorities. And our mission is really to promote excellence in Danish healthcare. So in anything we think as Danes we are good at in healthcare and where we can help other countries improve their healthcare system, that's what we work to inform about. So think about Healthcare Denmark as a gateway to Denmark, an organization where you can make a request if you think it's exciting what we're doing in Denmark and you want to learn more. We are proud to have our Royal Highness, Crown Princess Mary, as our patron. And in the mind of the princess, what we do in Healthcare Denmark is really also helping other countries to exploit what we have learned, what we have done in healthcare in Denmark. And it's really quite simple what we do. We have a visitor service where you can use our homepage to request a visit to Denmark. So if you think, I want to go see for myself, I want to visit this hospital or this municipality or Danish public authorities, to learn about certain solutions or excellence in healthcare, you can make a request to us and we have this visitor service where we will make the program, we will host you during your visit, and it's apart from your travel expense, it's actually a free service. We participate in conferences like here, also arrange conferences for Danish companies to have common booth. We go with ministers and the royal family when we have delegations going to other countries and typically run the healthcare track. We use communication and press to also spread the message and think about our homepage as the gateway to Denmark. That's where you can find stories about what we as Danes think we're good at in healthcare. That's where you can see which solutions and public authorities are involved in those solutions in healthcare we have in Denmark. I'm going to start talking a little bit about the Danish healthcare system so you understand a little bit about the context and the system we have in Denmark in order to better understand our focus on the next part of the presentation on transforming Danish healthcare to future needs. Our government, they realize that if we go 10 years out in the future, there will not be enough tax money to pay for the healthcare we want as Danes and we expect as Danes. Therefore, there's a huge focus on healthcare transformation. There's a firm strategy in Denmark on how we continue our healthcare transformation. It's about ensuring our healthcare is efficient. So when you go to the healthcare system, it's really healthcare just in time you receive. It's about bringing healthcare closer to the citizens, doing more close to the citizen, use the citizens' own resources. It's about patient empowerment and self-management. And I'm also going to talk about one concrete solution, namely virtual rehabilitation solution as one of the examples of technology and solutions which help us achieve these targets. And finally, I'm going to talk about another important part of making the healthcare system sustainable, namely to reduce the demand on healthcare services by focusing on population health and prevention. The Danish healthcare system is a public healthcare system where the focus is on free and equal access to healthcare services. That means that apart from the 16% out of pocket which Danish citizens pay for healthcare services, that's primarily in dentist area and some of the medicine we get, all healthcare is free. It's free to go to a GP, it's free to go to specialists, and it's free to go to hospitals. The size of the taxes we pay in Denmark, that's another story, but the good thing about it is that healthcare is free. General practitioners, GPs, they play an important role as our gatekeepers in healthcare because you need to have a referral, you need to have a GP who says, yes, I agree, you need to go to this hospital or this specialist to get more treatment, otherwise you won't go, or at least it won't be free. In Denmark, all hospitals, apart from a very small private sector, is owned and run by the healthcare regions. We have 5 healthcare regions, and their responsibility is to run all the hospitals. It's also their responsibility to handle the general practitioners. General practitioners in Denmark are private enterprises, but they get the majority of income from the public authorities, and it's the role of the healthcare regions to manage that. And the healthcare regions also is responsible for quality among the general practitioners. They have coordinators who monitor constantly what is the quality, are there any issues in terms of health economy or quality in treatment of patients. And in 2007, we had a healthcare reform to support the overall transformation of healthcare. We went from 271 municipalities to 98 municipalities, from 15 healthcare regions to 5 healthcare regions. And the whole strategy here was to create bigger units which could support moving healthcare closer to the citizens. So today we have 98 municipalities, and with the healthcare reform, they got a bigger responsibility for rehabilitation and for prevention. And they also got to control some of the monies for the hospital, 20% to be accurate, in order to motivate the municipalities to invest more in rehabilitation and prevention. And this is an important step, because this step and moving more rehabilitation to municipalities actually supported another big effort we had in Denmark, namely moving hospital procedures to outpatient procedures. If you have this organization in healthcare where you have better rehabilitation services in the municipalities, it's much easier to have invasive surgery in an outpatient clinic and then go to the municipality to get rehabilitation. So, where are we in the transformation of Danish healthcare? We're actually doing pretty well, because over the last 10 years or so, there has been a tough focus on increasing efficiency in Danish hospitals. Every year, Danish hospitals have had a target where they have to increase their efficiency by at least 2%. That means treat 2% more patients with the same budget and the same resources. And this is a tough target. Danish hospital CEOs know that if they want to stay on as hospital CEO, that's one target they need to look at. And therefore, the green curve shows that we're doing much more. We have much more higher efficiency in the Danish healthcare system than we have ever had. And the interesting thing is, if you look at the red curve, which is really our healthcare cost, it's this red curve which is a challenge for all countries, namely the spend in terms of GDP, spend on healthcare, where we're around the European average. In Denmark, this curve is now flattening out, whereas, as we saw in the introduction session, there was one speaker talking about ever-increasing healthcare costs in Germany and the US. So according to that speaker, in Germany and the US, this curve is continuing to go up. So higher efficiency, control over cost in economy, in healthcare, and still more patient satisfaction, or at least a stable patient satisfaction. This situation is also acknowledged by the European Union, which did a study in 2012, which showed that Denmark is ranking high in overall life satisfaction, but also in access to healthcare services, satisfaction with healthcare services among the European countries. So creating an efficient healthcare system, it's about reducing hospital length of stay. Because when patients go to hospital, that's where healthcare is really expensive. It's about reducing waiting lists to be more efficient. It's about access to new treatment and medicine. Because the fact is, if you use the newest technology, it may be expensive when you buy it. But the effect is that you reduce the number of retreatments and costs further out in the healthcare system. And it's, of course, as I said, about prevention and wellness. If you look at the hospitals, the focus has been on decreasing the length of stay. And today, Denmark has an average length of stay for inpatients of around 4.5 bed days. The ambition from the Ministry of Health is to get down to 3 average length of stay bed days for Danish patients. And again, that's because the focus is to keep patients out of hospitals, and the next focus is, if they have to go there, they should stay as short as possible. To make that possible, one of the focus areas in Danish healthcare is very much on logistics in hospitals, because that's where we see there's a lot of unused resources which we can actually get out to improve and shorten the length of stay for the patient. So it's really about just-in-time services for patients in the hospital. Bringing healthcare closer to the citizens. It's about changing the structure of the hospitals in Denmark. In 1999, we had 98 hospitals. Today, we have 40 hospitals, but that's not really the point. The point is that the role of those 40 hospitals has changed dramatically. They are either specialized in handling comorbidity and highly complex situations, because in the future, when patients go to hospitals, they need more highly specialized services, or they have changed their role into acute hospitals, which are specialized in handling acute services. It's about family clinics. Earlier in Denmark, a typical DP had one office where there was a DP. Today, we have nurses, we have more services done at DPs, and we're even expanding to build bigger family clinics, which also do more closer to the citizens. And it's, as I said, about municipality responsibility for prevention. It's about telehealth and the medical home, but it's also about ambient assisted living to keep our elderly people self-sustained in their own home, which is actually a big advantage because it's empowerment for the elderly, but it's also increasing their quality of life. I think it was mentioned by an earlier speaker that we have an electronic health record in Denmark. And it goes back 20 years ago when a guy in one of the health regions at that time did a study where he found out that actually more than 30% of physician and nurse time was spent handling paper. Finding the referral, finding the lab result on paper, finding the paper medical record for the patient. So this guy went to the Ministry of Health and said, well, what if we could do something about that? Then we could actually potentially save 30% of time in the hospital. We could transform that to, instead of handling administrative tasks, do more for our patients, treat more patients. And they received the idea, and the starting point was to create a health data network with the ambition to get rid of paper in the healthcare system, to get rid of the lab result on paper, on the discharge letter, the reimbursement, the prescription. And when we got into 2000, around 2002, Medcom was actually up and running, having achieved that target to 60 to 70%, still more to do, but at that time, most of the paper went out of the healthcare system and all communication between GPs and hospitals and municipalities was electronic instead of based on paper. And obviously the idea came out and said, well, but if we have that all that information electronically, if we have the EMRs in the hospitals, why don't we start using that to go even a step further, to help it empower our patients and get insight, and to help our clinicians improve the quality and data knowledge they have in healthcare. And that was when the idea came up about the eHealth portal, which went live in the first version in 2003. And the eHealth portal is really about empowering citizens. As a citizen in Denmark, I can look up my medical history going back to 1977 when the first databases came up, see any encounter, contact I've had with the hospital. I can see any prescriptions I have, what is the range of this prescription, how much did I get delivered against this prescription, can I get generic alternatives. I'm also empowered to make that decision as a patient. I can look up my electronic health record to see which clinical notes did the hospital do, which clinical notes did the DP do, and I control my own information. I have to give consent to who is allowed to see my information in the electronic health record in the system. Also, obviously, the Danish eHealth portal is about a medical handbook empowering patients when they have a symptom to look up and see, okay, should I actually consult a doctor, what is the situation here. But this is not only for patients, because it was also realized that this is a resource for healthcare professionals. So if I go to another part of the country, if I have an accident, go to another hospital, they have all my information. They can see all medicine I get, they can see clinical notes across the country, they can see all my lab results. It's a big advantage. It's really helping make our healthcare system efficient, and it is improving quality of treatment and reducing safety hazards. And from the outset, there were DPs represented on the SundhedDK organization, which worked to develop a medical handbook aimed at the physicians in order to also use it as a tool to increase their knowledge. As I mentioned, we are changing our hospital structure in Denmark. And over the next 10 years or so, we are building 16 new hospitals. We are modernizing a lot of other hospitals. We are investing $7.5 billion in new hospital construction. It's, as the Ministry of Health says, it's the biggest investment in Denmark since the medieval church constructions. It's an investment in the future. It's about ensuring that the new hospitals, when you go to a hospital, it's highly specialized. It's not only certain specialties, but it's also a close cooperation and more efficient cooperation among specialties to handle expected comorbidity about more severe patients coming in than going into hospitals today. Over the last years, we have done a lot of pilot projects in Denmark. In COPD, I think we have more than 20 pilot projects, and we have reached the stage where we have decided that now we have proven that telehealth is the way to go. Increasing support of chronic patients in their own home is the way to go. And one of the big benefits is really the effect of patient empowerment. If we look at those COPD pilots we have done, independent of each other, we have more projects indicating that if a COPD patient is empowered, we reduce hospital readmittance by up to 30%. And that's a natural reason for it, because when the COPD patient is empowered, that patient will tend to use the spirometer if they're feeling bad. They will look up what is the system telling me about this. Maybe they will take some more medicine, or if it's more severe, they can have an immediate teleconsultation with a specialist. If a patient, a COPD patient, does not have that kind of support in their own home, they will call an ambulance and they'll be taken to hospital because they're just feeling bad, they don't know what to do. So the really important thing about supporting patients in their own home, in our experience in Denmark, is patient empowerment. Get more knowledge about their own disease to the patient, get them engaged and more feeling more responsible for taking action on their own disease. Another important part of what we do in Denmark, as I mentioned, is the focus on elderly citizens, where in the same way we are right now running a lot of pilot projects to build up support for elderly citizens to be self-sustained in their own home. We have a number of very impressive demonstration flats in Denmark where we have combined all kinds of technologies, because this is not only about IT support, it's about a combination of technologies going from ceiling lifts to how to open a can of tomato, to how to lower your cupboards in the kitchen, to automatic blinds, to technology in your sleeping room so you can get out of bed, to technology in your bedrooms. We have a number of demonstration flats which shows how can this be done in Denmark and what is the right combination to support elderly people in their own home. So we have a very good situation. We have the electronic health record on a nationwide scale. We have that data to tap in for companies which will participate in where we go from here. And that strategy was announced last year, a very powerful coordinated strategy with the Ministry of Health, Danish Health Regions and municipalities behind the same strategy. And this strategy is really about taking chronic patient disease support and patient empowerment from being pilots to being fully regionalized implementations. Three of the Danish healthcare regions have the objective over the next 5 years to reach a situation where all COPD patients, they have this offer from the public authorities to participate in their own health, get empowered with chronic disease support in their own home. And next, we will focus on diabetes, heart diseases, also mental diseases is an area of chronic patients where this is an obvious thing to do. And this is linked to our strategy for ambient assisted living, where it's the same target. We have actually Danish municipalities today have a target on implementing ceiling lifts, because we have proved that case. We have proved that if you have a ceiling lift in your own home or in the elderly care center, we save a lot of resources in terms of extra nurses, and we made a better situation for the patients. Digital rehabilitation, which I'll talk about in a moment, is another technology which is proven, and we're looking into robot technology as a potential. And again, the strategy is to get to a situation where The ambient assisted living home or smart home, in another word, is not something where we do pilots. It's something that is beginning to be implemented for all elderly people in regions of Denmark. So now I'll talk a little bit about this concrete virtual rehabilitation solution. This is a solution which is the most widespread in Denmark, coming from a company called Welfare Denmark. And the solution is about supporting patients who have a situation in this example, a citizen who has a need that hurts. That citizen goes to a therapist, and the therapist finds out that it's a good case for virtual rehabilitation. The therapist set up a training plan and ensure that the virtual rehabilitation system is delivered to the patient's home. And then the patient can start doing the exercises. You can see a little box in front of the screen. That box detects the moment, the movement of the patient. So the system will not only tell the patient what to do, the system will monitor that the patient is doing the things in the right sequence, the right way, and the patient will receive points for doing it in the right way. And as the patient is using this virtual rehabilitation system in their own home, the scores are regularly sent through the mobile network, so the therapist in their office can monitor and they can adjust the programs if they find out that they need to lower the ambition. And they can also have a dialogue with the patient through the communication system. And you see how it works here. On the left side, you have a person who shows which exercise to do. On the right side, you have the patient with an image of the patient, how the patient is doing it, and being, again, tracked by the system. And you have different kind of smileys depending on how good the patient performed. I visited one elderly care home. I saw three patients using this under surveillance of one therapist. It saved therapist resources. It's something they can easily learn. One of the patients came in just the day before, and it's really something that offload our healthcare system. You can also have multi-user screens where more training plans can be set up and monitored, and you can have a team of patients using the solution. And obviously, the virtual rehabilitation system consists of a front end, which is in the patient's home, and a back end where you, as a therapist, administer and set up the system. And it's sending data in real time, so you can monitor the progress as a therapist. The benefits are definitely that you get fast and real rehabilitation according to individual training plans. You can do your rehabilitation in your home. Don't need to go and wait for a therapist being available. And you can do it with high frequency. Number of rehospitalization is reduced significantly. Some of the early studies indicate also 30% reduction in hospital readmittance because there's much more compliant with virtual rehabilitation. People feel more fun when they get their points, when they can do the rehabilitation as they want and not depending on where and when the therapist has time. And obviously, the benefits for the therapist is that they get documentation automatically about the test results. They can support and guide the patient. They can have more patients as a customer than they could before because they don't need to spend time personally, but can rely on this tool. The tool is also getting some very good feedback. Here's the municipality of Skanderborg, which says that they have been using it for 3 to 6 weeks, and they have really helped them improve the function level and the results of their patients who need to be rehabilitated. And this is definitely also confirmed by the questionnaires to the patients who have participated on a scale from 1 to 5. You can see the results here, which are really impressive. It motivates them to train more. It gives them insight and, again, kind of empowerment in terms of their rehabilitation. And the solution was even so impressive that earlier last year, it got the Microsoft Health User Group Innovation Award 2013 as a winner and being recognized worldwide as a very advanced tool by Microsoft. So the final part of my presentation will be about IT support population health and prevention. What are the Danish, what does the Danish government do, and what are the efforts to ensure that on the long term we reduce the demand on the healthcare system? And actually, earlier this year, the plan A Healthy Life for All Citizens came out from the Ministry of Health. It's about 7 very concrete targets the government wants to achieve over the next 5 years. Obviously, it's about smoke cessation, continuing that, even though we're in a quite good situation in Denmark in that field. It's about reducing alcohol consumption. It's about a focus on lifestyle and reducing obesity. It's about mental health, where we actually, as the Ministry of Health says, the ambition is to bring mental health to the level of other diseases, because what we see is clearly a difference if you go to a hospital for somatic disease and if you go for mental health. So we have an ambition to really improve that area. And it's also about securing this equal treatment in healthcare, where our experience is that when we start this focus on patient empowerment, it's worked really well for well-educated Danes. But there's clearly an area of the social space in Denmark where this does not work, and where we still have huge healthcare expenses. So part of the program is also focusing with special efforts on really also improving the healthcare of people who are in the social system. And this is about what we call integrated care. It's about linking the healthcare services with the social system. One of the companies in Denmark are actually building solutions where if you work in a kindergarten and you have a child who you think there's something wrong here, you can get an overview of who's involved with that child at the municipality and elsewhere, in order to increase the chance that we capture those social cases early and that we can do something before it ends up as an issue for the healthcare system. It's about screening and early disease detection, where for many years we have screened for breast cancer, but where we started this year to screen the whole population for colon cancer. And it's about an announcement 3 months ago that Denmark, as the first public healthcare system I know, is going to use personalized medicine to improve quality and reduce safety hazards in healthcare. There's a parallel session on big data. In Denmark, we already use big data as a means to improve prevention and population health. This example is a chart of Denmark where you can see the occurrence of diabetes. Dark areas, there's a big occurrence. Light areas, it's easier. And this insight into the data is used to have a dialogue with the municipalities on their effort in prevention, having a dialogue saying, well, it's strange because your neighboring municipality is having a low prevalence and you're just 5 miles away, you have a high prevalence. How can that be? Can you do more to reduce the risk of getting diabetes? We're also seeing in a situation in Denmark where we have 100% coverage of EMR, that we're getting out of this situation of just storing data in the EMR, which we have done for 20 years or so now in Denmark, to actually use it as an expert system. One example is a company called Treat, which has developed a system which takes data from the lab systems all over Denmark and are able to predict based on lab results and other indicators what is the best mixture of antibiotic treatment for patients with infections. And it's actually so good that it's better in predicting the right treatment than the physicians themselves, which are giving them certain issues with the dialogue with physicians, but still it's improving the efficiency and quality of our healthcare system. And if you look at where we are going in technology, and this is more my personal view, you can see the national colon cancer screening. We are targeting all citizens aged 50 to 74. Test kits are sent out to all citizens. They have to send in a sample, and there's a secretariat which monitor if there's a positive result, that they get the right patient pathway efficiently, high quality through the system, colonoscopy and so forth. But if you think about the future, and it was also addressed by other speakers, some of the tools we use today to monitor our exercise, they're actually starting to be able to monitor skin temperature and perspiration. If you think about cancer diseases, some of the cancer diseases can be early detected if you have a high temperature at night, just to mention one example. And so if you take one end, you have the Fitbits, iWatch, and Basis, And on the other side, you have ePATS, which is a Danish patch you can use to monitor your ECD, a one-channel ECD. So I think also when we talk about screening, the future is really also in those devices we are wearing, all of us. You also saw that in the introduction, it was mentioned, I think it was Samsung and Google, which will come out with a device which can monitor blood sugar. So with this last speech, part of the speech on oh yeah, I'll also mention, of course, the technology in lab tests where you can do much more with lesser samples, which enable you to follow up closely. And finally, personalized medicine, where we have a national biobank, one of the most impressive biobanks, I also think, in the country, and where the idea is to use that biobank together with the situation we have in terms of access to all lab results to introduce personalized medicine as a tool for the public authorities to make hospital treatment, our healthcare system, more efficient. It's about ensuring that based on your genetic situation and the information in your biobank, you get a much more precise and targeted treatment with drug and other terms of treatments in order to avoid adverse effects, quality issues, and safety hazards. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm ready for questions.